Good morning. What a pleasure to welcome you this morning to a program that I know you're going to enjoy. With me today are two very experienced dentists. In fact, if you take the three of us together, we have roughly 130 years of experience. I can pretty well guarantee you that I have suffered just about all of these things that I will not do again. And therefore, I can speak from experience as to why I won't do them again. And I'm sure the other two that I'm going to introduce in a minute would feel the same way. We don't learn enough in school to protect ourselves from some of these things that happen later once we get out and we treat patients. In fact, as I look at the overall evolution of a new dentist, out of school, I'll call that kindergarten. Then you go into, primary school for about 5 years of practice. You start to know what you're doing around that time because now you're starting to see some failures. By 10 years, you've seen a lot of failures. I made a video like this some years ago and I had about 20. You're going to get around 100 things that we'll discuss. This will be an extremely rapid fire program because we only have 3 hours. And to put all of that information in there, you will get bottom lines here. What happens if you don't respect that point that we're making? That'll be the bottom line. I'd like Dave to introduce himself. Tell him about yourself, Dave.
How you doing? Hey, I'm Dave Wright. I practice in Michigan, although I'm actually for the weekend in Florida, hoping to watch the Artemis rocket go up later today.
And you're close to it. How close are you?
About 8 miles away. So I should be able to see it beautifully from the beach right by my place. So listen, they call what we do practice, right? I mean, we make mistakes along the way. And then there's a term for when you stop making mistakes, that's called retirement. And so it's natural to make mistakes. The key thing is to learn from them. And I think hopefully we can share some of our experiences with you to help prevent some mistakes and some excitement in your life. I'm glad to be here today. I'm looking forward to it.
Now, Dave is in Florida, but he really resides in Michigan and Florida. Mike, tell him about yourself. There's a Floridian.
Well, Gordon, I'd like to introduce myself to the audience by telling them I'm a definite expert in the field. And the best definition of an expert is the person that has made every mistake there is to be made in a narrow field.
No, I think that's me.
Yeah. but that's all of us. And I think that, you out of our comfort level, which means we also explore dentistry as a profession. And I think this is going to be a course for everybody. I'm very fortunate to be with Gordon for a long time. I'm chairman of the board of Clinicians Report. And I'm very excited and proud to be here. I will tell everybody my strength is I'm an everyday practicing clinician.
Mike, it's a pleasure to have you here. And Dave, similarly, we have about 40 of these kinds of people who volunteered their time to work with us. Let's right now pull up share screen and get going. This thing is going to go really fast, so I hope you've got a pen and pencil out or you're pretty fast typing, because there are going to be many, many points here that we know we're not going to do again. And after 130 years, I think we've hit just about all of these, if not more than all of them. How about failures? Are they frequent? There are certain times when I'm doing something particularly difficult, I'll roll around in bed that night and I'll think, wow, what if this happened? What if that happened? What if the patient doesn't accept what we're doing? I've got a patient right now who's kind of grumbling and mumbling. And you wonder, what are you going to do? And you put an implant in, and thankfully I didn't do this implant, but look at that. I'm sure the guy who did that's off the internet, would feel terrible. Maybe the patient moved away or died or whatever. But in the meantime, why, with bone that looks good in the rest of that mouth, did that fail? One of our most popular courses right now, if not the most popular, is salvaging failing implants. that we thought were going to be there forever, and they're not doing it. Well, what caused that? Who knows? There are 20 reasons. Come to the course. Organization of this course. Watch these topics. We're going to do them directly as I'm putting them up here. And you'll see a whole flock of these topics. And in every one of those, there will be some subcategories that we're going to hit for about a minute and a half each with the challenges that we've all seen. Well, are we ready? Let's look. Diagnosis and treatment plan. I'm going to ask questions of the two mentors, and Mike and Dave, butt in any time. What is the effect of a crummy, awful radiograph that's just come into your practice and the patient doesn't want to pay for another one? What if you accept that? What's the problem, Mike?
Oh, it doesn't have diagnostic quality. We will often tell the patient we'll retake that x-ray at no charge.
Right on. That's exactly the way I feel. Dave, do you have any other thing to add to that?
Oh, absolutely. And oftentimes people will come in with, a recent pan, but, you know, we look at it and it's just not diagnostic. And because it was recent, I'll just take a new one. I won't charge them for it. The most important thing is we're able to help the patient and not let a barrier like, you know, whether or not the x-ray is adequate get in the way.
What's the bottom line? There are wonderful radiographs available to all of us. That particular one is done on a VATEC. That is a panoramic done on a cone beam device, the new VATEC. If you don't have machinery that will let you do this, for crying out loud, get it. What's the bottom line of this? Don't accept a crummy radiograph. Give yours away free if you want. We certainly do that, all three of us.
Spend time on training and put someone in your office in charge of being the head radiograph guru person. And just, you know, really focus on training. Education.
Let your staff know that if they've got a crummy radiograph, don't even show it to me. Take it over till you've got it correctly. Now, lack of adequate patient education, wow. Who educates the most in your office, either one of you?
Hygienists and assistants, and front desk, everyone but me.
same here, and I know Mike feels the same way. Now, there is a highly experienced dental assistant, unfortunately not with us. She had to move because of her mother dying, but in the meantime, that woman knew more than I did. And she could sit people down and tell them what it looked like it was going to be. Obviously, legally, she cannot treatment plan. She can't diagnose, but she can certainly educate. If you're not delegating to your staff the educational necessity in the practice, it's high time to do it. You have to have in-service education sessions, which we have at least once per month, sometimes twice a month. 1 hour, it's usually before the practice starts. And say we've got a new device. That new VATEC we've just got, we had to have an in-service session on that. And by the end of that, everybody's kind of geared up. We'll have another one to justify what good things and bad things we're seeing. Education is pertinent to that patient who's grinning right at the dental assistant. Okay, what about lack of complete diagnosis and treatment plan? The ADA says only 43% of American dentists or general dentists will do a complete diagnosis and treatment plan. 43% is pretty sick. 43%. These two mentors know very well what we teach in our courses here, and that is a staff-oriented diagnostic appointment. How does that work? Mike, how does a staff-oriented diagnostic appointment work?
Well, I'll come in, I'll greet the patient, and we'll have a 5-minute discussion. And then from there, the staff will collect all the data. So they may take 45 minutes to an hour collecting all this data. Yes, they can't diagnose, but they certainly can collect the data. Then they'll meet me outside, present to me a little bit about the patient's desires, what the patient wants, what the chief complaint is, and we'll put together a plan. I'll tell the patients about a diagnostic appointment. We need to get a set of blueprints. From that set of blueprints, we can decide on what type of house to build.